So in 2008, the Breves family of New York went on a family vacation to Brazil. It was a wonderful time. When they came back, though, they were reflecting and talking about all that they saw, all that they did. And one of the things they talked about was this animal that they saw. And so this animal was similar, but unlike what they were used to. And so this is the animal. Okay? It is called a coati, C-O-A-T-I, coati. And they're apparently all over the place, but here's another, aww, look at that, aww. So they're gotten to a discussion with the family, and one of the family members said, yeah, this is, this coati, this is a raccoon. It's in the raccoon family. And Dylan, the at that time 17-year-old member of the family, said, no, it's not a raccoon, it's an aardvark. And so they began this very heated discussion about whether this was a raccoon or an aardvark. And after the discussion, which didn't lead anywhere, they sort of went off to their respective places, and Dylan got on Wikipedia. Now, Dylan was an editor on Wikipedia and went on to the coati's article, and it said, and he read, that a coati, a member of the raccoon family. And so he edited it to say, a member of the raccoon family, also known as a Brazilian aardvark. Now, if you are unfamiliar with Wikipedia, part of what Wikipedia does is it allows anyone and everyone to create an account and become an editor so that you can go on and help to shape the knowledge of this online encyclopedia. Now, obviously, the problem is when you get funny funsters like this who decide to try and tweak things, but they have a system in place because you can't just go on and say that, I was the starting center fielder for the champion Atlanta Braves team in the 90s, because if you do that, it will allow you to do that, it'll allow you to make the edit, but there will be a little sort of thing up in the corner saying citation needed. Because the rule that they have in order to make sure that this sort of thing doesn't happen is that you have to have some sort of established press that you can point back to say, look, this was in the newspaper, this was on a major this was in a major magazine, this was in something that really mattered. Because they have other editors that are going back through all the time checking, and these silly things that get put on there all the time get wiped out. This is what Dylan assumed would happen. He knew that he probably had a couple of days, so he went back to his family, not telling them he had made the edit, and said, see, I guess we're both right. Agree to disagree. He didn't think about it again because he said, I just assumed it was going to get, just erased. I wouldn't have to worry about it. Well, a year later, it came back to his mind and he thought about it, and so he went back and he looked and he saw that not only was, coati, a member of the raccoon family, also known as a Brazilian aardvark, not only was it still there, but that one piece of information, which had no backing at all and was not in any way accurate, had been quoted in several major newspapers. So the problem here that some of you have already gotten to is that when Dylan went in and said, no, this isn't a real fact, Wikipedia said, yes, it is. Look, all of these places where it's quoted. That's how our rule goes, is that it's been quoted in these major articles. And in fact, a University of Chicago book that came out cited this as a source as well, which just goes to show you what you do citing Wikipedia. But Dylan was refused the right to, when he went back and took it out, it got put back in because there were these other sources the rule is now, look, all of these sources say, yeah, it's a Brazilian aardvark. So now it is. Now they eventually went back. This has become a phenomenon in all sorts of different ways. But this raccoon turned into an aardvark because of a funny joke. And then when he tried to make it right, the rule didn't let him. Because the rule, which was there to make sure this kind of stuff didn't happen, became the very impediment, became the very roadblock that kept them from getting to the right place. The raccoon became the aardvark. Now, trying to make sense of rules and how they work and how they shape and form what we do is not a new problem, is not a new idea. This is something that people have been struggling with and looking at forever. Now, it seems to me that there are two sorts of approaches that it comes to rules. There are those of us who are rule followers, right? Amen. I see that. I see those heads nodding. Thank you. And so rule followers would say, over here on this part of the stage, you aren't supposed to wear the color blue. So I would stand here, even though this is a rule, and somebody put this rule in place. So my natural inclination is to say, oh, okay. Whereas other people in the room, hypothetically someone I might be married to, would... I said hypothetically. They don't know. Would say, what do you mean I can't wear blue over here? I'm going to dress up in all blue and a Smurf outfit, and you tell me why I can't wear blue over here. That's a dumb reason. Again, hypothetical. But these two approaches sort of are both needed. As much as my sort of follow all the rules sort of brain kind of melts down, there are times where we just follow the rules and it becomes a problem. Now, there are times where we just burn it all down and that becomes a problem as well. But the balance of these two is what is needed. And when we start focusing more on just following the rules instead of understanding the reason and understanding where the rules are leading us, that's where we get into trouble. But not just us. People long ago got into trouble doing this too. If you have your Bible, you are invited to turn. If you don't have your Bible, you're more than welcome to find one of the Bibles in the seats in front of you or on your seat and turn to Luke chapter 6, starting in verse 1. If you are using one of these seat Bibles, it starts on page 1020 in your Bible. Luke chapter 6, starting in verse 1. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields, and his disciples began to pick some heads of grain, rub them in their hands, and eat the kernels. Some of the Pharisees asked, "Why are you doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath?" And Jesus answered them, "Have you never read that David, when he and his companions were hungry, he entered the house of God, and taking the consecrated bread, he ate what is lawful only for the priest to eat, and he also gave some to his companions." Then Jesus said to them, "The Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath." On another Sabbath, he went into the synagogue and was teaching, and a man was there whose right hand was shriveled. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal on the Sabbath. But Jesus knew what they were thinking and said to the man with the shriveled hand, "Get up and stand in front of everyone." So he got up and stood there, and then Jesus said to them, "I ask you, what is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil? To save life or destroy it?" He looked around at them all and then said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He did so, and his hand was completely restored. But they were furious and began to discuss with one another what they might do to Jesus. On one of those days, Jesus went out to the mountainside to pray and spent the night praying to God. When morning came, he called his disciples to him and chose 12 of them, whom he also designated apostles: Simon, whom he named Peter, his brother Andrew, James, John, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon, who was called the Zealot, Judas, son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. So when you look at that first part of the scripture, it can seem like a lot of discussion and a lot of talk about stuff that doesn't immediately translate. I mean, we don't argue or talk about Sabbath very much, except in terms of, you know, what we are doing, you know, honor the Sabbath when we talk about commandments. And we really don't talk, you know, there's not a lot of complaining or struggling about if we should harvest or not on the Sabbath, right? Or healing, anything like that. But Before we paint too sort of black and white a picture, what I want you to know is that in Jesus's day, and Jesus being a Jew, just like all the disciples and all the people he's interacting with right here, they couldn't get along with each other and agree about religion any more than we can today. So there are all of these different understandings and emphases about how you were supposed to be faithful to God. So you had the group, the Sadducees, who would have been their version of the country club sort of Jews. These are the group that thought your job and responsibility is to make sure that the people in power stay in power, both religiously and politically. They tied themselves to the people who were in political office, knowing that they could get not only, you know, hopefully eternal rewards, but they know that they could get temporary rewards and earthly rewards as well. So those were the Sadducees. And you had mixed in here these other groups, and you had this group that thought that it matters a lot how you understand your faith. It matters a lot that you come to your faith on your own, that you do the hard work for your own faith. It matters a lot that you pay attention to your own faith. So some other group can't do it for you. It is important that you are faithful and you do it and you follow God as best you know how. And that group was the Pharisees. Now, when we hear Pharisees in the Bible, we hear bad guys, right? But the reason that they are painted as the bad guys in the Bible is the same reason that you fight with your siblings more than you fight with anybody else, because you are more closely aligned and connected with them than you are with anybody else. And who are you going to fight with other than somebody who's exactly like you, right? So, the Pharisees weren't interested in sort of this, that, you know, they were doing what they thought was best, which makes this passage come to life for me even more, because what they are doing is they are struggling with who Jesus is and how Jesus is operating, because they can't make sense of how Jesus isn't following all of the rules and the structures that have been put in place. Because by this point, not only has the Old Testament, the 600 and something commandments in the Old Testament, been put into place, but you also have all of this oral teaching that has been laid on top of it, so that it's not just honor the Sabbath and keep it holy, but it is specifically how you do that. Because it's one thing to say, you know what, you need to honor the Sabbath. It's another thing to say, yeah, but what does that mean? Well, it means don't work on the Sabbath. Okay, yeah, well, what does not working mean? Well, these guys were happy to help, and so there were all of these different restrictions and rules and regulations about what working or not working was. So, for example, the guy with the shriveled hand, healing was specifically written down as a type of medicine. And when you heal, you are doing you are practicing medicine and you are working on the Sabbath. So what the Pharisees would have said was, listen, Jesus, healing is fine and all, but let's wait till tomorrow. The rule is more important than the person. Listen, Jesus, the healing is fine. This miraculous thing that you want to do is great, but let's schedule it so that it's not on God's special day. All right? And what has happened for the Pharisees and what Jesus was pushing against was for them to not become rule followers only, but to become God followers too. Because it's not that Jesus is saying, forget all the rules, do whatever you want, right? Jesus said, you know, all of the regulations of the Old Testament, all of that, I haven't come to abolish that, I've come to fulfill it. It's not that all of that is gone, it's that all of that has been found complete in me. So Jesus isn't saying get rid of all of the rules. Jesus is saying make sure the rules are leading you where you want to go. Because if the rules that you are following lead you to a place where you allow suffering to continue so that God's miraculous work can be scheduled around some sort of arbitrary setting, maybe you're not following God at that point. Maybe you're worshiping the rules. So the challenge here of what Jesus is doing is something the Pharisees have a hard time wrapping their brains around. And honestly, for some of us, we probably have a hard time wrapping our brains around it too. Because rules, we either find comfort, again, in following them, or we find comfort in breaking them. And we make sure we hold on to that comfort and that peace. But what Jesus is saying is, listen, whatever you do, you are going to be following some set of rules. Even if your rule is that I don't follow any rules, guess what? You're following a rule. Where are your rules leading you? And how are your rules shaping you? These may not even be things that you've thought of as rules. A rule for your life may be that I always eat ice cream right before I go to bed. Now that may be a wonderful rule, right? Except if you have diabetes or high blood pressure or any number of things which can cause problems. But it's still this rule that you are actively doing. See, rules don't have to just be I'm going to come to church every Sunday or I'm going to give money. Rules can be any number, any sort of thing that we continue to do over and over again that becomes established as a pattern. So what sort of rules are we following? What sort of rules are we doing, and where is it leading us? Because what God's desire then and now is not just for us to follow rules for the sake of rules. Jesus came to fulfill all of these rules. Jesus came to fulfill all of the law and the prophets. Jesus came so that we could follow him, not simply follow dusty rule books. Because in following him, we find one who continually pushes against, who continually moves, and who continually shapes us more so that we look more like Jesus, so that we respond more like God. Because we all know people whose rules, even if they are bathed in Christian language, have led them to be cold and mean and uncaring people. And that's not what God has for us. That's not who God is calling us to be. What God invites us to is a living relationship with Jesus, so that the rules that we follow lead us more into the love and grace and mercy and forgiveness, not just for us, but so that we can share that which we have been given with others. This is what our calling is, that we aren't just to be rule followers for the sake of rules, but the rules that we follow, the ones that God instructs us to do, lead us to the Lord of the Sabbath, not just to the Sabbath. Are you tracking with me on this? Do you see where we're going? That this idea that what God invites you to is not just this arbitrary set of rules where you don't wear blue over here and you only wear green on Thursdays, but instead a reality where you allow the things that you do, you allow the rules that you follow to shape you more into Christ Jesus, more into who God has invited you to be. This is not just something we do individually, this is something we do collectively as well. Part of what we are doing in our meeting today after Bible study is looking and seeing what are the things that we are doing. Because the events that we keep showing up to, the events that we keep putting on, those things that we give our money to and spend money on here in the church, those are things that are becoming rules. Those are things that are shaping us into who we are called to be. So each of our ministry groups, part of what we are doing today is challenging you to think about those things that we do. How are they allowing us to be more like what Jesus has invited us to be? More like who Jesus is and who Jesus is calling us to be, not just for ourselves, but for the whole world. So when we think about mission or outreach or facilities or the preschool board or any of these things that we do, how are the things that we, you know, what is God calling us to do in this particular group, and how can we more faithfully follow it? What do we need to tweak? What do we need to drop? What do we need to add? How do we need to let the Holy Spirit guide us in what we are doing? This isn't some sort of, you know, I don't want you to see this as just mundane paperwork that we gather together, we get this over with, and then we can hopefully go home before it gets too bad. You know, what I want you to see is an opportunity for ministry. Whether you are on the worship team or spiritual development or whatever, this is an opportunity for you to allow the Holy Spirit to come and invade this particular part of our work together so that we can be transformed. For example, the outreach team, when we go to the Bay Sox game, how are we treating that like outreach so that we are inviting other people to come and be a part of it? Because it's fine for all of us to go to the Bay Sox game and high five each other about how awesome we are as a church, but that's not necessarily outreach, right? Like, just letting other people see how awesome we are, I don't think technically counts as us reaching out and telling them. Tom, I need you to check me on that. But what if for the Bay Sox game, the outreach team said, you know what our passion is this year? We want everybody in our community to know who we are. And not everybody's going to come, but there are people who are driving by, maybe right now, who are desperate for what we have and who not only could be blessed by us, but could be a blessing to us as well. So what if for every ticket that you buy for the Bay Sox game, you think of one person who doesn't come here who would benefit from being in here, and you buy a ticket for them as well and say, hey, I'd love for you to come free to the Bay Sox game. Suddenly it's outreach, right? You see what I'm tracking? And we can do this for all of what we're doing. Obviously, it's going to look different for every single group, but part of what we are called to do is think creatively like that. You all know that 2017 has the opportunity, has all sorts of challenges already before us as a church. We have all sorts of things that we are facing and all sorts of ways that we could fall into worry, fall into panic, fall into struggle, fall into cynicism. But I believe that this could be our best year ever. I believe that, sure, we may have more people come, but that's not what I'm talking about. Sure, we may have more money show up, but that's not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about, for this to be our best year ever, what my hope is that when we stand here and do this again next year, we talk about how earnestly and how faithfully we tried to follow the Holy Spirit wherever God led us in 2017. Whatever crazy ideas we were willing to try, whatever big dreams we had that we thought, there's no way we can do this, but we feel like God's leading, so let's take this step of faith. I believe that's what God has for us. That even in the midst of the struggles that are real that we face, and even in the midst of the challenges that we see, we have the chance to be a vessel for what God wants to do here in Arnold and around the world. I'm so excited to be a part of it, and I hope as we gather this afternoon, you will have that same sort of excitement, because what God is doing is real, and God is eager for us to jump in and help as well. We don't just follow rules so that we can check off boxes and feel better about ourselves, because see, that turns us inward. The scariest part of this scripture is that the Pharisees were completely justified in their rules by saying this guy who is suffering needs to wait till tomorrow in order to get healed. The rules that they had completely justified that. In fact, they were claiming Jesus was wrong. And Jesus, as boldly and as clearly as possible, showed them the priority that God gives to those who are suffering and those who are hurting and those who are in need. That any rules that we follow that go against those sorts of people go against God Himself. How are we as a church going to respond to each other and to our world so that we aren't just following the rules that are good rules so that we can say that we follow these rules, which are good rules, but how can we shape and adhere to the rules God is bringing before us so that we can be transformed more into the image of Jesus. That is my hope and my prayer for each of you, each of our groups, and for all that we will do this year. And I can't wait to get going. Would you pray with me? God, for as eager as we are to follow you, we know how often we mess up. We know how often we are selfish. We know how often we think only of our comfort and our security. And so, God, we pray that you will forgive us. We pray, God, that you will help us to be open and humble and ready for where you are calling us to be, what you are calling us to do. Forgive us, God. Help us, God, to claim your grace and your love. Help us, God, to follow the rules that you would have us to follow so that we can be shaped more into the image of Christ Jesus, our Lord and our Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen.